So everybody, the heart of this session will be playing a card game with each other, which means if you're sitting by yourself at a table, you're going to have a really, really bad time playing cards.
I think so.
Follow these smart people and join a table with lots of other people if you can. We'll get going in just a minute or two. Inclusivity. Sorry. I never took a day of biology in my life, so please don't be offended by anything I say. I'm certainly going to get the biology wrong. You all know who I am, I hope, because I just did a keynote. I want you to get to know each other for a minute, because you're going to be interacting with each other a lot in this session. So let's start with quick introductions for just 2 minutes. Who are you? Why are you here? Introduce yourselves, please.
Continue to do these kinds of activities, and she became a child, just the IGDA.
I think some of the things we can really offer to developers is the opportunity to grow in their leadership. I think some of their needs have been in the industry since 1989. I'm currently working with
about 30 more seconds of introducing yourselves to each other, please. Wrap up in the next 30 seconds if you can. Sir, if you don't mind, if you can work a little better with what's going on for a year.
Yeah, I will pass games and over.
And now you can introduce yourself as well.
Classic train to Nintendo, Rockstar, and Ridgeman. Also originally Rockstar.
Wrap up in the next few seconds, please, real quick. You are already playing a card game. Different card game.
I'm Jonas.
You know what? Maybe as I'm happy with you now that we can form a fourth table and pull a few people from each table. How about that? How about you start here? No. When the game actually starts, if you two still just have two at the table, we'll pull a few from the table. Okay, everybody. Hopefully you all know each other. Hopefully you all know me. So here we go with the rest of the presentation and workshop. The heart of why we are here is to play the card game on the table, but I want to give you some context for that card game. So first of all, why do serious games work? I bet some of the people in this room know why. Everyone know what a serious game is? A game with a intention in addition to fun, such as education in this case. Why are serious games a good idea? Why do games work?
People learn through play. It's completely natural. That's how they learn.
Wow. Could not have said it any better. Keep them coming.
Games reward failure, and you learn through failure more than you do winning.
Wow. I didn't think we could get any more brilliance after the first two, and that was also brilliant. Who else is brilliant and has another reason why games are a good idea?
They engage the senses. You learn. Your brain throws even faster that way.
Absolutely. And?
It's a disarming mechanism to get people to start talking about things, so it sounds fun from the get-go.
Hear, hear. Anything else to add?
Just games are fun.
More here, here. Wow, what a awesome.
You can compete without hurting other people's feelings, so you can actually bring your best or your hardest or whatever it is to the table and not worry about.
You know, in all
the fun with that, cooperation, because also competition is great on gaming, but also cooperation is great. For example, you cooperate with other players to compete with other players, like Counter-Strike, MOBA.
Excellent. Anyone else have quick thoughts to add? In all honesty, I was planning about a 5-minute section on why I made this game, but you all just gave me much better answers than I ever could have given you, and yes, all those reasons is why I wanted to make this game. So my personal mission in life is to make work a better, more enjoyable, more engaged experience for as many people as possible. I think games are a fantastic way to spread some of the science of happiness and employee engagement. Let me show you just a few minutes of what is typically a half-day workshop to give you some context for the game. The problem I'm focused on this time is unhappiness, which according to science drops your performance about 25%. That's obviously an average. Your mileage will literally and figuratively vary. Every brain in this room, every brain in the world is different. And you cannot take averages from science and data and say, it's going to work for you all this way. It won't, because you're all different. But on average, if you look at a meta-analysis of studies, unhappiness or low well-being seems to drop performance for high-performance jobs like yours about 25% on average. Solid peer-reviewed science gives us the flip side of the coin. It's possible to choose more happiness at work, and if you do, you will experience a number of benefits. For the skeptics in the room who are looking at these books and thinking, science? Ha! looks like pop psychology is self-help bullshit to me. Anybody mind if I swear? It's a little late now, but. If this looks like baloney to you, I will point out that most, if not all, these books are written by, or the very least about, PhDs doing peer-reviewed research at places like Harvard, University of California, etc. This is the real deal science with random assignment, placebo control, peer review, duplication of results, all the stuff that makes good science. Now, science is far from perfect. This is a relatively new science, but just know again that I'm trying to give you as little of my opinion as possible and as much grounded in solid science and data as possible. All that science says it's possible to choose more happiness, and that if you do, your brain will work better in a number of different ways. Specifically, numerous studies behind every word on screen, happier people are more productive, energetic, cooperative, creative, resilient, successful, and engaged. Happier people make more money. And let me make this abundantly clear right away. According to science, it's far more that happier brains work better, produce better results, get promotions and pay raises, and therefore end up with more money, and far less that money buys you happiness. Science says if you want to become rich and successful so that you can be happy, try it the other way around. Work on your happiness, and that will lead, for most of us most of the time, to greater success, including wealth. In part because our attention broadens when our mood is good. You will notice somebody is getting uncomfortable in the meeting sooner in a good mood than a bad mood. You'll notice that the quality of the concept animations, of test animations, is dropping just a hair sooner in a good mood than a bad mood. You'll also find better solutions. Your intuition, creativity improves. As scientists put it, you increase your behavioral repertoire. That is, you have more tools, virtual tools in your tool belt to solve those problems you find. You think more creatively, you come up with better solutions, you are healthier and you live longer. Happier people show up in the emergency room less, they show up at work more often. I wanted to be all of that, which is why I dove deep into the science of happiness when I discovered it about a decade ago. I want all of you to be a bit more like this if possible, which is why I'm here today. And I want the working world to be more like this, which is why I quit my career in video game development and specifically resigned from Intel to do work like this full time. And as you can see, I'm getting back to games through this work, which is the best of both worlds as far as I'm concerned. How do you get all those awesome benefits? Science tells us happiness is largely a choice. And there are lots of things we can do to choose more happiness in work and in life. I organize a lot of those choices you can make around these four themes: soothe stress, practice positivity, flow to goals, and prioritize people. Those are the categories of the solution cards in the decks that we are going to play with in just a few minutes. So I'll come back and I will explain those again in a moment. Any questions or comments before I tell you a few more things about happiness in general before we dive back into those themes? I take silence as I totally understand and I completely agree. So don't sit there thinking this is a bunch of baloney. Objections, questions, comments? Excellent. Let's define happiness so we're all talking about the same thing. This is how scientists, and therefore I, define happiness: as positive emotions, which are wonderful and short-lived. And then we're all back to a happiness set point we seem to have that varies from person to person. We are talking about those positive emotions, and positive emotions are wonderful. They just tend not to last that long. So we're also talking about, on top of those positive emotions, a sense of meaning and satisfaction with life and with work. I'm a good friend, I'm a good producer, I put on amazing events. Whatever brings meaning to your life, we're talking about that deep, lasting, meaningful sense of satisfaction as well. According to some research we did at Happy Brain Science, depending on how you were raised, that sounds maybe more like joy than happiness, or maybe more like happiness than joy. Turns out we feel the opposite about some of those words depending on how we were raised. Just know that throughout this session and this game, I mean that deep, real, lasting sense of happiness when I say happy. Three things I want you to know about happiness in general before we get back to those themes. The first is that according to science, it is much better to pursue frequent happiness than really intense happiness. Or, as science might say, if you are waiting for one thing to make you really happy in your life, stop waiting. Because science says it won't make as much difference as you think and the effect won't last very long. Red Sox are World Series champions and then last place in the American League East. And with very few exceptions, the events in our lives don't have significant lasting impact on our happiness. There are a few exceptions, but most of us, most of the time, adapt. And therefore, events don't matter that much. Anyone happen to see the San Diego 2012 fireworks, either live or over video? Well, you're all about to. Picture the scene, you and your game development friends pile out of the van, you spread out a blanket, you're awaiting an hour-long extravaganza, and due to a malfunction, you get this. This is not time lapse. Due to a malfunction, an hour's worth of fireworks went off in under 1 minute. You're seeing 99% of the fireworks display in San Diego 2012. So your colleague who's 1 minute late comes running up and says, dude, I missed the fireworks. How were they? And you say, really intense. So he says, so they were awesome? And you say, no, they were kind of lame and disappointing. Decent analogy for happiness. Don't go for it all in one moment. You will actually get much more happiness out of it if you spread it out in lots of little ways. Sorry I have no cash for any of you, but as one example of many, if I gave you all $1,000, science says you get much more happiness out of that grand, spending it $20 and $30 at a time, than all at once on one thing. I will definitely write you all checks for $1,000. I will not cover the $25 fee that you will all get if you attempt to catch them. So, pursue happiness frequently through lots of little things rather than one big thing is going to suddenly make you happy. Before we go any further, let me get this out of the way. There is such a thing as being too happy, and good news, I'm not it. As much as I love happiness and have made a career out of it, I am not one of these clown-nose, rainbow-wave people who's like, hey, it's so great to see you all the time. I find those people mildly annoying as well. So I will drive this home with just the very end of a story with my wife. I come home from a day at Intel. I'm fighting traffic on the way home. I get home. There are toys everywhere. And despite it being a beautiful, sunny day, rare in Portland, my hometown, sun coming through the windows and hitting me on the chest, I am essentially whining. And then, waking up. I hadn't planned on taking a nap, so I turned to my wife and I said, I think I fell asleep there. And she said, I should add, with love in her heart and a smile on her face, she said, quote, oh yeah, you were asleep. Want to know how I know you were asleep? Because you weren't complaining. So, that's my anecdotal evidence to you that I am not just Pollyanna positive all the time. And we're at the very fuzzy correlation only end of the data, but the data suggests that none of us should be chasing constant bliss. It's unrealistic and unhelpful. And in fact, data suggests if you get kind of desperate about happiness, like worried about your happiness even when you're happy, it's a really good way to be unhappy. So don't get obsessed with happiness. Unpleasant emotions are normal, natural, healthy, and helpful. I really can't stress this enough. Scientists like to coin words. A recent word they've coined is emodiversity, which is getting at the fact that if you experience the full range of emotions, joy plus despair and hopelessness, great moods along with really grouchy ones, you actually thrive the most in life. Those who report that they are 8 out of 10 happy, or since we probably have a room full of visual people, if you can picture the Mona Lisa, according to the University of Amsterdam, she is 83% happy. 8 out of 10 happy, people who say they're 8 out of 10 happy are most healthy, most engaged, most successful, live the longest. Why? Again, that emo diversity that scientists like to talk about. Also, we're into speculation from scientists, but the speculation starts, if you say you are 10 out of 10 happy all the time, you may not be engaged with reality. Like, life is hard, right? Bad things happen to us and the people we care about, colleagues we work with. And if something bad happens to you or somebody you care about, the appropriate response is to feel bad. and that can be useful, healthy, and helpful. So please don't take this workshop and this game as I should constantly be blissed out all the time, unrealistic, unhelpful. This is how to choose to be happier in the same set of life circumstances if you'd like to be. If you think happiness is something you're born with or not, you are very roughly about half right. We know this from studies of genetically identical twins separated at birth, adopted and raised in different families. Some scientists' favorite people on the planet, because they're our best source of information about how human genetics affect behavior. And what we find is very messy, which is why it may be a little hard to see in this lighting, but there are overlapping colors in this pie chart, because if you go home and say, oh, I learned that your happiness is exactly 50% genetic, not quite. If you look at a large group of people, including genetically identical twins, and you compare their happiness, very roughly about half of the difference between one person's happiness and another person's happiness seems to be due to genetic factors. Some of us are born looking at the glass half full, some see the glass as half empty, you're wired that way, and that affects your happiness. What was very surprising to me, and maybe to many of you, is that by some scientists' estimates, all of your life circumstances is only about a 10% impact on your happiness. What? All I'm doing is working on my life circumstances so I can be happier. How can that possibly be only a 10% impact? Because of what scientists call hedonic adaptation. That's a fancy scientist way of saying you basically get used to everything you have in your life. And yes, there are exceptions. Again, these are averages. Science is averages. If you put me in a war zone and torture me, I will be miserable. But for most of us, most of the time, the difference between driving a Saab and a Subaru, living in Ballard or Capitol Hill or Portland, working at one game company or another, all of the circumstances in your life are only about a 10% impact on your life because you're getting used to everything you have and everything you do. And that leaves the 40% that we are here to focus on today, choices. What scientists call intentional activity. What you choose to think and do, what's going on between your ears, has a significant impact on your happiness. So we are here today to choose more happiness in the game that has content organized around these four themes. So let me briefly explain these themes. Soothe stress. Why? Because stressed out brains tend not to work ideally at work. When you are in fight or flight, which is not a switch, it's a continuum, your brain figuratively shrinks, you start thinking more like your average house cat than human, and you see only three solutions to any problems. Fight, run, or although you don't hear about it as much because it doesn't rhyme, your number one response to immediate stress is just freeze. Because if you shut up and stay still, the mountain lion might not see you and you might get away. Awesome for mountain lions, not so awesome for game development and each other and the problems we encounter in game development. So I want you to soothe stress in part by not stressing about your stress. There's irony here, but a mistake that a lot of us made for a long time is when any stress comes, we then compound the stress by stressing about our stress. Oh, this is awful, I'm so stressed out presenting. What if I do a bad job presenting? Wow, I'm really bad, oh, this is really bad now, I'm stressed out. Bad for my blood pressure, bad for my health. I could die from my stress. I'm killing neurons, now I'm really stressed out. Stop stressing about your stress. If you'd like help in this regard, see an excellent TED Talk by Kelly McGonigal about befriending stress. Those who view stress as a helpful, energizing stress cope better. They feel better, their health is better. And if that doesn't work, cope effectively with things like physical exercise, social support, and mindfulness or meditation. All fantastic coping skills.
She has a full book on the upside of stress.
She does. I haven't read it yet, have you?
Very good.
Excellent. So the book is good as well as the TED Talk. Thank you, Jed. Jed? Excellent. Practice positivity. What does that mean? It means a bunch of frankly cheesy, corny sounding attitude stuff you've probably heard before really works. So when you see cards in the deck that are like, well, sure, that's sort of like, that is great. Science says that actually works for most of us most of the time. Positive attitude, optimism, seeing the best in each other and each other's work. Flow to goals. We're getting into the most overlap with the engagement keynote I have here. progress towards clear and meaningful goals fuels happiness as well as engagement. So this is about progress towards clear and meaningful goals and focusing completely for 20 minutes or more on something challenging and possible, which gets you into that zone that psychologists call flow. And the way you get out of flow is to multitask, which is why I want you to minimize your multitasking and maximize your flow towards clear and meaningful goals. And last and certainly not least is prioritize people. If you had to boil the science of happiness down to one word, well, I would be out of a job, so that would be a bummer. But according to Harvard scientist Daniel Gilbert, that word might be social. We are social creatures. We need each other to be happy. Some of us need each other more than others. Some of us need more people than others. But all of us, introverts and extroverts, get a boost from human contact. So prioritize people is about investments you can make in the quality of your relationships with other people, including your colleagues. I don't know about you, but I used to feel like, why would I want to be friends with people at work? I don't choose my coworkers, I choose my friends. I don't need more friends, why would I try to be friends? Wow, what a lame attitude I had for a long time. You spend more time at work than you probably do in any other part of your life. Why not make friends there and earn more happiness and engagement in the process? So prioritize people is about investing in warm, genuine, caring relationships to boost happiness and engagement. Questions about any of this before we go into the game? Excellent, here's how we play the game. I am looking for a volunteer. Oh, wait a minute, first we need to do a little mixing. If you're gonna stay, Jillian, would you mind coming over here? And could I get one more volunteer from each table to join these handsome, kind gentlemen over here so that we have a good, healthy mix of numbers from table to table? Oh no, did we just lose the gender belt? No, okay, all right, good. We've got diversity and equal numbers. Awesome, yes, diversity survives. Excellent. So I would like a volunteer at each table to grab this salmon-colored box that is labeled solution cards. And in that solution deck, you should find on your table, you should find over 100 cards. So wait, before you shuffle, you should find, I hope, on top a number of card category cards. Those are not part of the deck. Take those out, please. And yes, I'm asking for real people to do this in real time as we do this together. So those card categories, you can take those out. Apologies if they're shuffled into your deck there. And then what you have is over 100 solutions grounded in the science of happiness and employee engagement. Please volunteer, deal seven of those cards to everybody at the table, including yourself right now. Dealers, seven cards each, solution cards. You can pick them up and look at them when you get them. Don't show them to each other. You know, on the fly, I change from six to seven. What do you think, six or seven? Whichever you prefer. Seven. Six, seven, I don't care. Just deal some cards to each other, please.
Looks all very positive.
No, you can keep the extra cards out. Those are in your deck and we'll be drawing from the orange cards.
I'm laughing a lot at this.
So go ahead, you can take a look at your cards if you like. Should have seven each. So the icons in the middle of your solution cards show you the category they come from that we just went over. Those categories are in the cards or the handouts on your table. You're going to want to move those handouts out of the way pretty soon so we can play. Anybody not ready to go on? Excellent. Then the person to the left of who just dealt, could you please grab the other box and take the 100 or so scenario cards, also known as problem cards, out of that deck, cut that deck, and take two cards off the top. You are the first judge. Those of you who just grabbed the gray scenario cards, you are the first judge of many judges. Please take the top two cards off that deck. Look at both of those cards. Judges, look at both of those cards, pick one, and then tell your table which one you picked by reading it out loud, or even better, translating it into your own words or your own actual scenario at work. So judges, the four judges, pick a problem you want solutions for. Tell your table about it briefly, please.
Oh, okay, 1 second.
All right, let me get your attention again, please. We're almost done, and then I'm going to free you up to play. So judges hopefully just told you about a problem they have at work. You need more time?
Our judges are done.
Another minute for judge.
So most of the time people are talking.
All right, now judges, have you described your problems?
Yes.
Excellent. So being gamers, most of you know what comes next. The rest of you, besides the judge, look in your seven cards for a solution you think would help with the problem you just heard about from your judge. There are two ways to get points in each round. One is to provide the best solution, and what you're often going to find, to be frank with you, is that sometimes the solutions you have won't be a direct match with the problem you just heard. That's when you go for the single point, the second place winner, which is most creative or humorous. Now, let me make abundantly clear, every solution in here is a serious science-based solution. But in certain contexts, some of those solutions can be humorous. So if somebody says, I have a problem with a really negative colleague, and somebody says, you need to take a vacation, that's kind of funny. It might work a little bit. So, all of these are serious solutions. Some of them can be funny or very creative in the right context. If you don't have a winner, you think, then go for most creative or humorous. Now, if you played apples to apples, and I'm sure many of you have, there are some significant differences here. One is you are openly lobbying for your solutions. So you don't give the judge the solution card down, you give it face up, and you say, let me tell you why mindfulness is an excellent solution to your problem. Because blah, 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 put it in your own words and openly lobby.
Okay.
Couple things here on solution cards before we go on. Occasionally you'll find one that says create your own solution. That means do exactly that. Same with the scenario problem. You can describe a scenario in your own words if you happen to get one of those cards. Also, some of these cards say, everybody try it now in bold. And the suggestion is, if somebody proposes that as a solution, as soon as it's proposed, you take just a quick minute and try that solution because it's something you can do in the moment. On a solution card at the bottom of the text, it says, everyone try it now. That means, everybody try it now. So a judge then picks the best solution, explains why it's the best solution, and part of what we're after here is, again, each of us is different. Science is averages. So solutions that'll work for most people most of the time does not mean it's going to work for everyone all the time. Part of this game is learning about your judge, learning about each other, how each other thinks. So judge picks the best solution, explains why it's the best solution, picks the most creative or humorous solution. Those people get 2 points and 1 point respectively. I don't care whether you keep track of the points or not. It's fun.
Points don't matter.
And then at the end, everyone who played a solution card draws another, so you're always holding seven, and judge roll moves to the left. Questions?
How do the points work again? What's 1 point?
2 points for best solution, 1 point for most creative or humorous. Easy way to do it is just make a stack of cards that represent your points. Any other questions? Anybody not clear how I'm asking you to play? Game on. Have some fun.
I really think that to solve your problem, you should take more visualization micro breaks things. You can talk about how we are rich and famous.
So part of being famous and well known is getting your face out there and having people remember you. There's almost no better way to do that. Actually connecting with people on a personal level. And finally, or at least a change in the machine, make sure they know you did it. Well, actually, being recognized, sorry, that's right, you have to get some PR out of it. So this is really the best way. That's the point. You want to be famous? Remember where you got that. That's what I think you should be doing. This will help you so much.
But seriously, this is kind of a courageous conversation. We really need to sit down and talk to somebody about what it would take to get there. This is actually a reliable goal, or a realistic goal for you. And now that's going to be a tough conversation.
This is all
understand where you're going and how to get there.
So right now, we all actually take a moment. Okay.
if you can record yourself driving to work listening to your music.
How are you ready?
If not, you can record yourself.
So if you don't have the goal anymore, you have the goal and you can't achieve her. We're connected to the goals and you can't achieve her. So in that situation, you want to find somebody already for either all of mine or kind of really able to achieve that.
I've got a super wide lens. I need to get
No, it's not making any sense. That's the problem.
Right.
it to me.
Your brain thinks that you're making progress.
I
don't know. You're not asking to make any progress.
I'm going to argue this
one. I'm looking at all the objects that get this one. And really,
my problem is that I feel
trying to tell you something. You're not being distracted by stuff that you have to realize you're not actually helping by stressing and thinking about it. You're just distracting yourself and therefore missing something that maybe someone needs to tell you.
I don't know.
I think it's really changed
things.
And then I think the community tables and gatherings.
Thank you for the warning. I think I have to go. I think that you need to quantify your difference. So you need to be doing a self-writing yourself, do a thorough and accurate job, and try and be definite. You need to do the difference is kind of like that. Just don't feel bad. Get back to the why.
Questions, answers, and comments about all the content of the game. So what I want you to start doing now that you know how to play the game is as you see really interesting solutions go by, if you see something that you're like, what is the science behind this weird one? Just pocket it or set it aside, ask me about it in a few minutes. If you see one that's like, oh, I definitely need to do this with my team, set that in a different place, etc. So in a few minutes, we want debrief and discussion about questions, comments, and most importantly, how you can apply some of the solutions you're seeing in the game. Any questions or comments before I get you playing again? thanks for letting me blab at you for a minute. Play on.
Really, at the heart of all is communication. Just try it, shake it up, like see if you can like make it till you make it. Or something like that. And then people hopefully will have a dialogue.
Yeah, that's a better place than I thought you were going to go. Like, as long as you get your boss.
For some reason, I'm not going to be able to do it.
I think for the silly factor, I was going to go with the same index, but I like your story.
I'm feeling
and for the more serious answer, I'm going to go with I feel. I have a social work background, so I'm very much into that. Feelings are very hard to argue with. And they invite conversation.
So I have to share my workspace with you.
Having a boss that listens to me. That's a big one. I'm grateful for having some willing participants in the security process at work. They're actually already doing it. It's just good.
Get earphones for each other and spend each other's. Spend money.
Less than words. Race cars.
I am grateful. I have the most fantastic team I'm working with right now. The whole thing about the work with people that you working the electrical project here, I think it's really great concept that we can see other people have gotten close to, but we think we've got some really good skills. And
I thought it was great.
His race car is almost done, so then he can go back to the track. I keep hearing about the fact he can't get to the track.
I'm also grateful that I
employees,
Yeah. All right. Come to wrap up. Come together in one conversation if you can, please. So thank you all for playing. It means a lot to me. I should have said this at the beginning, but this game is in beta. So I would welcome any feedback or suggestions you have from brilliant game designers and game builders. I want to spend the last few minutes doing questions and comments. Let's start with questions. Anything where you were like, what? Why is this a solution?
You need an occasional card that pops up just every once in a while that's HR violation.
So, yes, that is
really fast.
That is a good point and a good opportunity for me to say that I have precisely zero human resources professional experience. I work with a lot of HR people, but I have not been trained as an HR professional. So, is it possible that I am suggesting something to you that would violate some policies in some companies? Absolutely. Please don't let me get you fired. Good comment. Other questions or comments? Please.
So I used to work for a company that is culturally different. And a lot of the things that you pointed out in the keynote and here, I feel works in a Western culture. But it's really hard to ask them to change that, even though they have a branch here, because the real upper
Yes.
What do you do about that?
Expansion packs.
What'd you say?
Expansion packs.
Expansion packs. Yes.
Expansion packs.
Yes. If somebody more culturally savvy could make a bunch of expansion decks for me, that would be great. But in all seriousness, this is a moment for me to say, look, I'm extremely biased. I have, with the exception of 1 year in New Zealand, I've always lived and worked in the United States. And to be clear, most of the science behind all those solution cards is Western science. Typically, not all of it, there's a lot of other groups in the data, but by far the most common group is US college students because they're available to psychology researchers. So, beware the cultural influences, adapt if necessary. When we ship the game, I'm gonna suggest lots of hacks to the game. One way to hack the game is to stack the deck. Go through all the scenarios or problems and say, I don't care about this one. This one's fit for us. No, this is fit, this is fit, this is fit. No, yes. Make a deck that's just for you. And then solutions, like, oh, in my Asian culture-based organization, this would never work, this would never work, this wouldn't work. This. Create your own subset of the game, and you might have a better fit in a way that I couldn't tell you. But by all means, it's a very Western-oriented game. Only thing I have to encourage you, despite some of the cultural challenges, is that Sonia Lyubomirsky, the woman who wrote The How of Happiness and is a leading researcher in the science of happiness, was born and raised in Russia. When she first came to the US for college, she thought it was absolutely bizarre that people were smiling at each other so much on the streets who didn't know each other. She went from that cultural shock to being a leading researcher on happiness. So some cultures embrace happiness more than others. Some cultures think it's selfish to focus on happiness. My belief is if you define happiness the way scientists do, you actually become a better, more group-oriented person by being happier. So therefore, I think it can work with most cultures, but I do not in any way, shape, or form claim to be a cultural or intercultural expert, and I really applaud the comment. Thank you. Yes.
Can I disagree with you on that?
Sure,
point?
Please.
I actually feel like a moderator running the game, trying to cater the appropriate responses to their audience, is really counter to the potential value that can come up. Mm-hmm. You know, having solutions that you may not think are the best solution, but giving someone the opportunity to propose that, and you know, there's a reason that solution is there because it has some backing
for somebody.
For somebody.
Yeah.
Having someone put that forth and explain why they think that could work, even though it may not be appropriate for your company or your office or your thing, I think would encourage people to think about, you know, why couldn't it be a fit here? Why couldn't that be a solution?
Yeah, excellent comment. And part of the game is to learn about each other and how each other thinks. So if you have somebody on your team who happens to be born and raised in Japan, you might learn things about him through the game. Like, oh, he never chooses solutions that are about his own accomplishment. He's always focused on interpersonal interactions when he chooses a solution.
And, in fact, even expanding on that, I would love to see more cards added with solutions that aren't Western. Like, I would take the opposite approach. Rather than trying to pull the cards to take it down to something that fits an Asian audience or any particular audience, add cards from multiple cultures.
Excellent.
Expansion path.
Yes. Quick check-in with the group. It is now 12:16. I'm supposed to have let you go. Five is shut up and let us go, or I will kill you, Crabtree. One is this is a great conversation, let's keep going. This is a finger bowl. I say 1, 2, 3, 5. 5 means let us go. 1 means let's keep going for a few more minutes. Clear on what I'm asking you to show? 1, 2, 3, throw. A whole bunch of people want to stay and some want to leave or need to leave. So, okay, so how about this? If you want to leave, great, thank you. I'm not trying to move and kick people out, but I understand people have lunch meetings and things they got to do. If you got to go, great. If you want to stay, I'm delighted to stay for a few more minutes and talk about the game and what we're learning. Thank you, everybody, for coming if you have to go. Yes?
I was just
going to
say, expanding on what Matt said, I like adding new things to do questions to the deck. So have you ever seen Cards Against Humanity?
Yes.
Like you go online and you can actually type in your own responses. So if you can make this open source where people could add in their own questions, you might be able to build on things that different cultures or different companies have on.
I am totally going to do that. That is genius. Thank you. That's a great idea. Yes. Please. So let me test a hypothesis on you that I seem to have observed playtesting this with Boeing and various other companies. Groups that come together that don't know each other like this take a much longer time to warm up. Groups of people who already know each other, they hit the ground hard. But I mean, round one, they're like, exactly. So I think your suggestion is especially right on if you're bringing a group of together for the first time as opposed to, oh, we're all on the team every day, we work together, let's play this game over lunch.
And when you start slowing down,
Great feedback, thank you. Yes, Carlos.
I'm not sure it will be cards. It's the same thing. No, it'll be you can't feel it. I'm just going to get it.
You're saying have everybody vote on the best solution.
I'm not sure it's totally going to work.
Yeah, interesting. I should try it. Test and learn.
I'm not sure going up and off.
It's just a whole different. Yeah. Good suggestion. Other questions or comments? That is a question I would love to answer. Where do you get the cards? I'll let you know when it's released. I have a little page on happybrainscience.com/game is a place to sign up if you want to know when the game is released. You know how stupid this is to say if you've ever made a game in your life, but I'm hoping to ship this fall. So,
3 weeks to the solstice.
We'll see what actually happens. Should I wrap up? These people said they weren't staying, but should I wrap up anyway?
If they're hungry, that might be a thing.
We started serving lunch.
Thank you all for coming so much. I would love your one-on-one questions and feedback.